Julia Bernard, better known as Julia Brown, was born in Louisiana in 1845. Little information is available about her early life, as her story has primarily been passed down through oral history. Despite this, it's very probable that she had very little formal education, instead becoming accustomed to voodoo practices, which she was likely taught by her relatives. Around the 1860s, Julia lived in New Orleans. During this time, it's thought that she used her abilities to help people with illnesses. Her methods were similar to that of a traiteur or a faith healer. Back in the 19th century, there were many healers in Louisiana. These included healers belonging to the French-speaking Homer tribe, Cajun healers, and voodoos. The treatment used by traiteurs involved prayer, medical remedies, and laying hands on patients. These people were essential in Louisiana because of the lack of doctors and physicians in many rural areas. So, faith healers such as these took their place tending to the well-being of local populations. It is said that traiteurs would only perform treatments if they were asked. Moreover, their services were always free, as their healing abilities were considered a gift from God. As Julia got older, her voodoo abilities improved. Some sources even claim she was a priestess or queen. At some point during the 1860s, she left New Orleans, moving to a small settlement 25 miles to the west called Frenia. The village of La Frenia was named in honor of the Attorney General for Louisiana, who was called Nicolas Chauvin de La Frenia. The first settlers had arrived in La Frenia back in 1850, and as time passed, the community grew and the village's name changed to just Frenia. Here, Julia served as a midwife and healer for the town's small population, using her knowledge and whatever materials she had at her disposal, mainly herbs and natural remedies. During the mid-19th century, many German immigrant cabbage farmers moved to the three small towns on the southwest edge of Lake Pontchartrain. These were Ruddock, Frenia, and Napton. Before long, these communities became prosperous, self-reliant logging towns, relying heavily on the cypress tree. Despite the three communities growing in size, with new people settling there, the infrastructure was poor. There were no roads, no electricity, and no doctors. All they had was a nearby railroad which delivered them goods and supplies from New Orleans and exported their logs, cabbages, and lettuce. As strong winds were common in these areas, the settlers made sure to build sturdy homes, which were built 8 feet off the ground to deal with rising waters. Census records tell us that in the year 1880, Julia married a man called Celestine Brown. Not much is known about Julia's husband, except that he worked as a laborer in Frenia. Julia remained in Frenia for the rest of her life, occasionally traveling to the larger neighboring town of Ruddock to treat locals. In these towns, especially in Frenia, Julia was heavily relied on. Yet, despite her importance in the community, many of the townsfolk took her for granted, only turning to her when they were in need. Some sources claim that she was well liked by the locals, but at the same time, it has been noted that many avoided her. Aunt Julia Brown, as she became known to the locals, supposedly lived at the edge of a swamp away from the rest of the village. Furthermore, rumors existed about her being a voodoo priestess who practiced dark magic. According to the local legend, she also became known as Julie White or Julia Black. Records tell us that Julia Brown's husband was given land by the federal government in the 1900s. In total, they owned 40 acres, which was used for farming. Sadly, in 1914, Celestine Brown passed away. There was no mention of the couple having any children, so Julia likely inherited the plot of land after his death. Aunt Julia Brown was known to sing songs that she invented on her front porch while playing the guitar. Usually, these were fairly normal melodies, but one day, she began to sing some especially troublesome lyrics. A local woman called Helen Schlosser-Berg stated that the words to this new song said that one day she would die and everything would die with her. This eerie song was very disturbing for local residents, making it very unforgettable. As the tale goes, in the months leading up to her death, locals would frequently hear Aunt Julia Brown sing, "One day I'm going to die and take the whole town with me." The exact words of this lyric varies. According to an article from 1972, what she actually said was, "Oh, when I die, I'll take half of Frenia with me." Some locals interpreted this ominous song as a curse. Although originally, only some locals suspected her of being a voodoo, following the events of her death, everyone believed it. Aunt Julia Brown passed away on the 28th of September, 1915, aged around 70. Her funeral took place the following day and was attended by the entire town. Also, as she was well liked, some people came even as far as New Orleans to mourn her death. Yet, some of the townsfolk attended for other reasons. It's thought that some were fearful of a premonition and hoped that this would ease her spirit. Others, meanwhile, went out of guilt for how they treated her in life. In any case, it made no difference. On the 2nd of October, 1915, the New Orleans Times published an article which described the events of Brown's funeral. Many pranks were played by wind and tide. People had gathered for miles around to attend the funeral of Aunt Julia Brown, an old lady who was well known in that section and was a big property owner. The funeral was scheduled, and Aunt Julia had been placed in her casket, and the casket in turn had been placed in the customary wooden box and sealed. At 4 o'clock, however, the storm had become so violent that everybody left the house in a stampede, abandoning the corpse. The corpse was found Thursday, and so was the wooden box, but the casket never has been found. The Category 4 storm that struck during the funeral service seemed to have come out of nowhere. It later became known as a New Orleans hurricane of 1915. Evidently, those in Frenia had no idea that a hurricane was about to hit the town. However, this was mainly due to the settlement's isolation and because they never usually received any newspapers. In the larger town of Ruddock, the train that passed on the morning of the 29th September threw off a newspaper which stated the likelihood of a hurricane. Despite this warning, it made almost no difference. The harsh storm had winds of 125 miles an hour, and the storm surge made water levels in the local area rise by 13 feet. In Frenia, the locals had no time to get to safety. Some of the townsfolk managed to make it to the railroad depot, but sadly, it collapsed due to strong winds, resulting in the death of 25 people. Many faced an even worse fate, drowning in the Manshack Swamp. One lucky survivor later recalled how he held onto a cypress tree for dear life, and how he tried to block out the screams of those dying in the swamp right next to him. Some families were lucky enough to get on the train which was headed for New Orleans, but it was forced to stop as the track was covered with debris. The survivors later noted that the only tracks left were those under the caboose. The storm devastated many communities in Louisiana as it swept through the state, but it completely wiped the towns of Frenia, Ruddock, and Naptom off the map. The railway that connected them to the rest of the state had washed away, and virtually every building and house had been demolished. Once the storm subsided on the 1st of October, it was recorded that there were around 300 casualties in Louisiana, with 60 of them being Infrenia and Roddick alone. Those who survived the hurricane Infrenia gathered the bodies of their deceased neighbours and buried them in a mass grave. As most of the village was consumed by the rising waters, the cemetery was located on the few bits of land still above the surface, right next to the Manshack Swamp. Years later, a sightseeing business placed makeshift fences and crosses all over the cemetery. Julia Brown had a separate grave from those who lost their lives in the storm. It was around 100 yards apart from everyone else. Today, all that remains of Frenia is the cemetery. To this day, legend states that the Manshack Swamp remains haunted by the Voodoo Priestess Julia Brown. However, it's very likely that the life and legend of Julia Brown has been manipulated in order to increase tourism in the area. Manshack Swamp tour guides will tell the popular, more interesting tale that Julia Brown cursed the town, provoking the storm. Yet some have different opinions. It has been stated by former locals that Julia was not a revengeful type and that she was well liked by the townsfolk. Nowadays, many people associate voodoo with black magic and curses, yet mainly it's to do with healing. Although it's impossible to know the exact truth, there's a chance that Brown's song was actually a warning to the townspeople about the storm that was about to hit. However, since her supposed warning was quite unclear and ominous, it's hard to believe that these were her true intentions. Thank you everyone for watching this video on the Voodoo Julia Brown. I really hope you enjoyed it. Leave me a comment if you think that she did curse the town or if you think they were trying to warn them. If you have any suggestions, please leave me a comment or send me an email in my description. Anyway, I'll see all of you in the next Forgotten Life. Thanks!